So welcome to Unleash, and I'm going to go straight in because I think that you have a super fascinating story to tell. Okay. And I know obviously that you started the business in 2004, and that was done from your spare bedroom, which is obviously not unusual in the startup world. But I'm just really keen to learn more about that and how the business has developed from, you know, March 2004 and where it is today, 17 years later.
Okay, Jesse. Well, firstly, thank you very much for having me. I'm looking forward to this myself. So in terms of phase three, as you rightly say, I started the business in March 2004. So we've just celebrated our 17th birthday or anniversary birthday. Not sure which one. either way. And I guess we started, our story is that we started more or less like a niche recruitment business in the HR tech space. So it was just me, and we put bums on seats in a very much a recruitment style approach, and we did really well, and we punched well above our weight in terms of some of the projects we won and some of the brand names, and unfortunately upset quite a few vendors along the way. Those vendors, which are now our friends, by the way. So it's funny how that works. Yeah. But you know, it didn't really feel like a business. There was me. Then we recruited, got a couple of other people, moved to a very small office, but it was very much focused around myself and those two individuals. So we kept that up for maybe 8 to 10 years. And there was only three of us. And then only around 2014, 2015, did I decide that actually I want more than this. I want a proper business, for want of a better term. So we decided to recruit an internal team in terms of back office and then delivery and so on and so forth. And fast forward to 2021, and we are today a leading provider of people technology consulting and services. Exceptional reputation around the UK, where the majority of our work is based, and the business is split into three distinct areas. There's consulting, there's services, and there's connect.
Well, that's amazing. 17 years is a long time. You know, so first of all, like you were saying, congratulations. I think it probably doesn't seem like a long time to you because you've been so immersed in it, but actually almost two decades in business and growing, which is the most important thing, is pretty impressive. So I also wanted to talk to you about, you know, people, right? Like, we know people are the biggest asset within a business, and we often talk about a people first approach. But I just wanted to get your take on that in terms of what does that actually mean to you?
Okay, so people first, I think it's summed up in one word for me, really, and that's empathy. Mm-hmm. You know, being truly empathetic towards your team, your people, and your approach. I mean, everybody's heard the term, you know, put your take care of your people and they'll take care of your business. You know, you can't. There's variations of that term every day. Whenever I'm scrolling on LinkedIn, it's all over the place. But it's so simple. It's such a simple philosophy, and it's so true as well. You know, there's no great science to it. There's no great complications to it, and I really struggle to understand why businesses would. You know, I don't quite comprehend why they take any other approach. Mm-hmm. You know, so we've been, as I said at the start, we've been that 2 or 3 man company, and now we're touching 50. And so you have to adapt, you have to evolve to that. And I think employees right now as well are looking for a lot more from their role. It's not just the paycheck, you know, getting paid at the end of the month. They want to feel like they belong, that they're valued, that they're cared for. And I think there's a narrative at the moment in the media, Jesse, about, you know, working from home and flexible working being enough. You know, there's I think it's PwC actually in the last couple of days said that, you know, everyone's going to work from home forever. And there's talk of a 4-day week and all this kind of stuff. I don't think that's actually enough. I think it's been sped up because of COVID, of course. But I actually think that it's about communication. You've got to ask your team. A great example of this actually is, as good as we think we're doing in the people first approach at phase three, one of our colleagues recently approached us and said, actually, guys, we think that some of the benefits, the perks, the bits and pieces, the initiatives you have are actually suited more to perhaps those with families, mm-hmm. The parents, those with young children. And it's actually made us think about how we need to adapt our approach, because it's a 10,000 piece jigsaw that you're never going to complete. There's always moving parts. And I think it's about finding that balance, Jesse, really. So, you know, ultimately for me, I don't want my team to have that kind of, that Sunday night dread. Oh God, it's work tomorrow, you know? So we're putting things, initiatives in place, which hopefully kind of, make them feel a lot happier about coming into work. And just on that point, I think, you know, not everybody wants to work from home.
Mm.
They want the flexibility, but perhaps, you know, when I was in my 20s, a long time ago, fair enough, but I wouldn't want to work from home. I'd want to go into the city centre. I'd want to go for the after work drinks and the mingling and the whole social element of it. You know, fast forward 20 odd years, yeah, the working from home has its perks. Of course it does. So as I said, I think it's about finding that balance.
And I think it's also really exciting that employers are listening more to people as well within their organisations. But for you as a business leader, I know that comes with its own set of challenges, right? And it's particularly when you want to do things properly. I think that's the key. Mm-hmm. So you've been in business for almost 2 decades, and I imagine the workforce, the labor force, the demands from people and from the industry have changed so much over the years. But how do you, as a business leader, make sure that your people first approach continues over time?
Okay, that's a good question. I think it comes down to communication and listening to your team. You know, we've touched upon different initiatives. So for example, we have an initiative where we implemented late last year, unlimited leave. Now, research tells you that the majority of the companies that implement unlimited leave, their workforce actually takes less leave than they did before the unlimited leave came into place. So what we've done is we've had a minimum figure that you have to take. So there's 25 days you have to take, and then anything on top of that you take as well. So it's about understanding what those little small nuances are within the different perks, you know, and we want to ensure that it's more than just work-related benefits. So we try to get actively involved in, you know, if someone's moving house or if they've had a baby or, you know, real life events, basically. And we want to see the team grow in lots of different ways. But I think you have to live those values that you have as a business. And I think ultimately, it's about putting people at the heart of company decisions.
So I think we both agree that culture really is like the most important thing, right? And that technology is the enabler. And there's so many tools out there when it comes to like empowering your people. But how do you at phase three use technology internally to ensure that you are people first? And how has that changed over time, particularly going from a team of three to, you know, yeah, almost 50, and also just thinking about how you're continuing to grow?
Okay. So if I answer that in kind of two ways in terms of how our people first approach has evolved, and then the tech we use, if that's okay. So I think it's fair to say we probably weren't always a people first business. I don't think we had the people in the business to be a people first approach, but the main thing that really shaped our people first approach is our former MD, lady called Kate Wadia, who tragically passed away just over 2 years ago. It was a bad time for the business. She was such an amazing person, and I learned so many things from her, but one of them was just her empathetic approach. Mm-hmm. It wasn't false, it wasn't put on, that was just who she was. And honestly, it was an eye opener, Jesse. It really was. She would, you know, often to the detriment of herself, she would put the entire team forward. Everybody would go to her to ask for work-related queries, life-related queries. And, you know, if you can have that approach and genuinely put yourself in people's shoes, then, you know, I think it's amazing. And I'm from a generation that when I started work, it was very much 9 to 5. Well, in fact, actually probably longer than 9 to 5, you know, shirt, tie, suit and all that kind of thing. And I've kind of seen that change over time now, you know, and I'll argue till the cows come home with anybody that, you know, me doing this interview now in a hoodie versus doing it in a shirt and tie is going to change my answers or change my mindset in any way, shape or form. It isn't, you know. Now, don't get me wrong. If someone wants to go to work in a shirt and tie and all that, absolutely no issue with it. But you don't need to, is the point. And I think that's the bit that we need to understand. So our approach has certainly changed as we've evolved as a business. And then to answer the second part, I suppose in terms of technology. So we have our kind of full remote access. We have our HR system with which really manages employee engagement. We can offer surveys. We use a AI-based well-being tool called Wellbot, which helps to kind of pick up trends, mm-hmm. how people are feeling throughout the days and throughout the weeks. We use Perkbox. We have an EAP. We've just implemented a learning management solution now for training courses and stuff. So there really isn't any excuse from a technology point of view. I touched upon it earlier, but COVID has certainly sped that up. Some of the solutions out there at the moment, be it employee engagement, be it payroll and pay on demand and all, honestly, it's amazing. You know, the innovation that we're seeing, you know, we've probably fast forwarded, 5 years, 10 years, something like that in the last 12 months. And we're not stopping there either in terms of what we have, but it's a good starting point. It's a good base to then move forward from.
For you as a founder to openly acknowledge the impact that other people within the organization have had, but also to talk about how you've also learned from the people around you, I think is really important. So I'll congratulate you on that note as well. And
thank you
so much for speaking to us. I really enjoyed the chat and I hopefully look forward to doing it again soon.